the, this is the initial condition, so x approaches y. Let's say that x.
So I have an initial condition, I have these two solutions, I have these two equations, I would like to solve them. So I said write down a solution. So the way that we would write down a solution is we would say that I could just use some kind of Green's theorem to solve it by finding an appropriate propagator and convolve the propagator with the initial condition. So let me do this explicitly. This part just comes along for the right, so I'm going to have the same zx minus zy to the h, and zx bar minus zy bar to the h bar. And now I will start convolving. So there are some values over here, which I will convolve with a bulk-to-boundary propagator. This is not our old ADS bulk-to-boundary propagator, but a de Sitter bulk-to-boundary propagator. So I integrate over what region? I will want to be using the advanced propagator. If I use the advanced propagator, then my solution here only depends on the causal path that I have over here, so that I can only use my initial conditions for the period which lives over here. So that means that I will integrate over a dummy variable w, which ranges this way, over this little region here. I will integrate from zx to zy, because that's the full extent of my w region of integration. And the thing that I'm integrating is g sub h, so the some Green's function which is which solves the wave equation for the conformal dimension h, with zx, which depends on zx and zy. It tells me about this point over here. Given a point w at infinity, at past infinity in the Sitter space. So that's the notation I have over here. And I will have a similar integral over dw bar, going from zx bar to zy bar, for gh bar of zx bar, zy bar, given w bar. And the thing that I'm actually smearing is this initial condition. That thing was already written there, so I just have to write h bar of where my initial condition was, which is the ww bar. So this is another expression for the OPE block, which is equivalent to the expressions we found before. So now we have a bunch of different expressions. One thing we said yesterday is that the OPE block is an integral of a bulk field along a geodesic. Our very initial starting definition was that it was just the sum of all descendants of a given field that can occur in an OPE expansion of a product of two operators. This is a closely related but different expression, which works only in d equals 2, because only in that case I have that factorization of my two time directions, the two different time evolutions, for some kernel. So you may ask, so notice that this is a very interesting expression, and the reason why it's an interesting expression is that I would like to draw a piece of the CFT. Here's my point x and here's my point y. And let's think about what this region of integration actually is doing. We're integrating over the causal path of this point in that de Sitter and in that de Sitter. What is that region? It's the region that takes me from the left moving coordinate of x to the left moving coordinate of y. So it takes me from this line to that line. I guess this is right moving. So it takes me from this line to that line. And what about this guy? This integral takes me from zx bar to zy bar. So it takes me from here to there. So altogether, what my region of integration is doing is actually taking an integral over the causal diamond, which is spanned by x and y. And that's the region of integration. But what am I integrating? I have some kernel, and I'll say a few more words about the kernel in a moment. But the thing is, I'm actually integrating is just the primary field, which is smeared everywhere. Notice that this is similar but different to what we had before. Because what we had before was that I wrote, in cartoonish terms, I wrote that the OPE block was equal to the
with some normalization to the primary field, and then I had the and then I had 1 plus the descendant plus the next descendants and so on.
So it was a sum of all of these descendants. But here what I'm doing is just smearing the primary. I'm never using the descendants. How is that possible?
Well, every time I had some function in front of this, so a typical term here would be like some number times x minus y mu v mu, yes?
And then there would be some higher terms. Every time I see an object of this type, I will interpret this as a translation of O by some finite value, which is x minus y. That's what this thing is really doing, interpreted as a Taylor expansion. So an expression of this type that I had in the definition of the OP block could be equal, it was a sum of descendants, but interpreting descendants as primaries translated over, I can replace that expression by a smeared expression over just the primary. And that's what this thing is doing. So our initial conditions and our equations of motions, that's one thing that they allow us to do, to write the OP block as just a smeared primary. And how am I smearing it? Well, the way that I'm smearing it is given by these propagators, yes? But so what the propagators are doing from the point of view of the smeared expression is that they are giving the correct weight for the smearing. They choose the weight for the propagators and this propagator together. They choose, let me write it here, they choose the weight for smearing. So, just what kind of weight would be correct, or how would you know that this is the correct weight, or what the correct weight is? Well, let's think about it. What we're trying to do is to create an object that lives on SO21 mod SO11. Cross SO21 cross SO1, 1. So what these integrals are doing is performing a smearing over this entire SO1, 1 and over this SO1, 1. That's what we're doing. We're taking the zero mode of these symmetries in order to obtain an object that lives on the quotient. And that smearing, or that taking that zero mode, is being performed by these, by this integral with that kernel. So the kernel is chosen to take the correct symmetrization over SO1, 1. So this gives me a very nice, so let me give you a mini test of whether we understand what I just said. But the mini test is this one. Suppose that I choose h bar being equal to 0. H bar being equal to 0 means that my field completely doesn't depend on the right moving coordinate, yes? So, but I still have to do this expression over this integral over here. So in that case, when I perform an integral dw bar from zx bar to zy bar of gh bar going from my zx bar, zy bar over w bar, but my h bar is equal to 0, so I'm actually integrating over a field which doesn't depend on my SO1, 1, what should I get here over? And the answer is I should get infinity. And that infinity is not just any infinity, it's the volume of that SO1, 1, because I'm integrating a constant over this non-compact thing. So this thing would just be the volume of SO1, 1. So that's an example of what this thing is doing. In the special case where I don't have a variation, the integral just gives me, spits back the volume of the region of integration. So for fields which are chiral, which satisfy this condition, or a similar condition for H, the statement is that this thing will be infinite, but this infinity is just a change in normalization. So I would just skip doing that integral in the case where, in the case of a chiral field, to obtain a finite normalization. But in other cases, I have to perform the integral explicitly. So let's find the, and I have some other comments to make. So clearly the SO1, 1 is one of these SO1, 1s is the symmetry in the left moving direction. And one of these SO1, 1s is the symmetry in the other light going direction, yes? Now, I could take their even and odd combinations, and their even and odd combinations are going to not go in the light-like directions, but they will go in the time-like and in the space-like directions, yes? So, the orbits of this SO1,1, of these two SO1,1s, when I take their even and odd combinations, they are going to generate for me the space-like and the time-like Killing vectors, which preserve the causal diamond. So one such combination is going to be this one. And the other such combination is going to be this one. These are the even and odd combinations of the generators of these two SO1,1 symmetries by which I have divided. And this one here is special to D equals 2. And the reason why it's special to D equals 2 is that in higher dimensions I would have more spatial directions, so, well, I mean, which way are the arrows going to go? But this one is not special to D equals 2. This is the completely general way in which, this is a completely general way in which a higher dimensional version of a causal diamond, so a causal cone in a higher dimensional CFT, is being preserved by some Killing vector. And many of you will be familiar from this Killing symmetry, because this is the one that's being used in the construction of Cassini-Huerta and Myers' special coordinates, which are adapted to ADS Rindler space. And what these lines are over here are really just time translations in ADS Rindler. Well, if I had a bulk, then they would be translations in ADS Rindler, but an extreme radial slice of ADS Rindler is the one that lives on the boundary, and that's the one that I drew for you over here. But this admits an extension into the bulk, if I imagine there's a radial ADS direction going on there, and these would be the time translations in ADS Rindler. What are time translations in ADS Rindler? They have another name. They are trajectories of accelerating observers in ADS. So what these things are just the trajectories of accelerating observers in ADS pulled to the boundary. And anyway, I'm just making these comments to make this symmetrization look a little more familiar, or to demystify it a little bit. What we're doing, in effect, is performing an average over what an accelerating observer in ADS would see. And this is the correct way of doing this symmetrization. So there is an explicit formula for these propagators. So the explicit formula for this propagator is that GH of X and Y and W equals ZY minus ZX, ZY minus W times W minus ZX over ZY minus ZX to the power of H. And there will be a similar formula for GHY. And when I take those two formulas and plug them in, this is my explicit smeared form of an OPE block in the CFT. So I can now ask you, have we seen this before? This is my, this is my rhetorical question. Have we seen this before? And the answer, if I ask this question, you already know that the answer will be yes. So let me tell you where we have seen this before. So to talk about this, and one thing that I promised to do yesterday was to tie in together the lecture from the day before yesterday and the one from yesterday. The day before yesterday was all about entanglement entropies, and the one yesterday was all about operators in the bulk of ADS and Witten diagrams. So how do we connect them together? So we're now going to connect it in some way in answering this question. And to do this, let me start talking about entanglement again. So we remember that we defined this as minus trace rho log rho. And what I would like to do is to, so this is going to be a detour that will take some 3 or 5 minutes, and then we will be in the position to answer this question. So for my detour, I want to introduce one extra little piece of notation and to say that this thing, this rho A, the reduced density matrix on some region A, is equal to the exponential of some operator, and that operator I will call minus H mod. So what is the good thing about writing down this formula? Well, one thing that's good about this formula is that the rho in this language, rho is sort of thermal. So if I chose the modular Hamiltonian to be my time evolution operator, then rho would be a thermal state. So that's the reason why we choose the word H and call it some kind of Hamiltonian. But you will see that, or you can see that intuitions from thermal physics will carry over to this. So that's why it's a good thing to do. And in particular, one thing that's good about it is that just plugging in the definition of H mod, I see that this thing is equal to the trace of rho A of H mod. In other words, it's the expectation value of H mod in the state rho. Now, okay, so what I have done is just introduced some operator which has the property that if I evaluate its expectation value in my state, then I get the entanglement entropy. You should remember that if I change the state, then this operator would also have to change. And so this is not an up. Okay, so saying that the expectation value of H mod gives you the entanglement entropy is not true for every state in the system. Or it is true, but it requires, but only if you allow me to change what operator I mean by H mod every time. But it is true for this state rho, and it's going to be true for small deviations away from rho. So for example, if my rho was equal to the vacuum state, it's the outer product of it's the density matrix which corresponds to the pure state, which is the vacuum. And if I now take my vacuum and send it to some other operator, which is 1 plus epsilon O times the vacuum, and epsilon marks that this is a small perturbation, let me call this phi, then in this small perturbation, okay, so now rho A, which is the trace of A complement of 0, 0, is going to go to some new, okay, this was my reduced density matrix of A. If I perform that change, then this thing will go to some rho A plus delta rho A. And it is still true that the expectation value of, that the change in the entanglement entropy of A is given by the change in the expectation value of H mod, by which I mean the expectation value of H mod in the state rho plus delta rho minus the expectation value of H mod in just rho alone. So this is a statement that the first order variations, it is still okay for me to take this expectation value, but now in a new state of the same operator to get my changed entanglement entropy. Yes?
Don't you need this change in H mod?
So for this statement I don't. And let's just prove it quickly. So what I want to say here is that if I have a ds entanglement, which I have on the left-hand side over there, then this is minus delta of trace rho log rho, which is, and now the delta can act on two things. So I can have a minus trace of rho, and the delta of log rho is rho inverse times del rho,
And then I can have the delta acting on this term, and it's just minus the trace of del rho log rho. So in that term, rho and rho inverse cancel, and del rho, I assume, is still is traceless because this was a density matrix with trace 1, so this also has trace. So this must have trace 0. And so this whole thing goes away, whereas this one is again my minus h mod, and so what I have is h mod, I have trace of del rho h mod, which is what I wrote over here. So good. So I have this equation, and by the way, this equation has a name that goes with it. This is a change in the entropy, so let me write it as ds. And in the philosophy where my rho was thermal with respect to this change of the Hamiltonian, what this thing would be is like dE, okay? And so this would just be the first law of thermodynamics if I had some t here. But of course, my choice of t is just the choice of normalization for the Hamiltonian. So I just have ds equals dE, and this is called the first law of entanglement. So why am I telling you about these facts? I'm telling you about these facts because in a paper that I already mentioned in this talk by Cassini, Myers, and Latta, they wrote the modular Hamiltonian, which is this object, and they wrote an explicit form for it. And the explicit form for it is in two dimensions, in d equals 2, this expression was exactly the expression that we had over there for, so let me just write it out explicitly. It was equal to minus 6 times an integral from zx to zy of zy minus w, w minus zx over zy minus zx, and that's dw, and an integral dw bar from zx bar to zy bar of zy minus z, zy bar minus w bar minus zx bar over zy bar minus zx bar times T00, which is the energy density in my CFT. So this was the expression that they wrote for d equals 2. They didn't write it in this form, but it's equivalent to what I wrote over here. So, in fact, I should probably say that maybe I should write it in a different way. So let me just rewrite it in a way that's equivalent but better. What we would integrate here is Tzz of w dw plus the same thing with w going to w bar. Okay. And this is the expression that I really wanted. So that's the modular Hamiltonian, and we recognize now that this modular Hamiltonian is in fact equal to minus 6 times the OPE block for the holomorphic part of the stress tensor plus the OPE block for the anti-holomorphic part of the stress tensor. So that's what it is. Why is that true? That's a question that I want to ask you next. To the extent to which this is true, and I just told you that it is, we already have made some connection between the language of the OPE blocks from yesterday and the language of entanglement entropy from the day before yesterday. Because this object, H-mod, it knows all about entanglement entropies to first order variation about the state. And those, apparently knowing about that, is equivalent to the physics of just those two OPE blocks, which is what we talked about yesterday. Are there any questions about this?
Just a technical question. Delta of log rho, why is it rho inverse delta rho?
Oh, well, if this was a constant, then I would just, if this was a function, then I would say that it would be d rho over rho.
But they're not commutative.
So they,
Well, rho and log rho don't commute?
Delta rho and rho.
Oh, delta rho and rho don't commute. That's true. So there will have some fun. True. So I have to be more careful about this. And there will be some more complicated expression here, which will involve...
It won't cancel rho, though.
It will not cancel rho.
It's a very complicated expression, indeed.
Which will not cancel rho.
The rho inverse you had there, which conveniently cancels rho, and then you had trace of delta rho, which is zero, will not happen.
Let's see. So...
It's going to be something like rho to the minus s, d rho, rho to the 1 minus s, or something like this, and then by cyclicity, it will cancel. It's an integral over s.
Good. So is the conclusion that it cancels or that it doesn't?
I think it does.
Okay.
In a funny way.
Okay. So thank you. So I was sloppy, but the result holds. Okay. I'm okay with that. I mean, I know that it's true because I've seen it used 100 times, and I never thought about this. So yes, I mean it had to be true because someone else would have pointed out to me earlier. But yeah, good. So anyway,
so let me just, without writing what I had previously, let me just write this as trace zero del rho, and that will be fine.
Good. But back to the story here. So I have this expression for the modular Hamiltonian, and it happens to be equal to a combination of these two OPE blocks. So why is that true? So let's talk about why that's true. And to do this, I will remind you of something else, which was pointed out sort of in passing the first time that we met, which was that the entanglement entropy is equal to the limit, as this is what the content of the replica trick is equal to the, let me start in the middle, is equal to the limit as n goes to 1 of 1 over 1 minus n times the logarithm of these of a two-point function of two operators which have conformal dimensions c over 12 times n plus 1 and minus 1 over n, and this is the expectation value of the modulo Hamiltonian. So what I would like to do is to change this modulo Hamiltonian, as in, sorry, not change the modulo Hamiltonian, but to change the state, to vary the state a little bit. So I'll put little deltas everywhere. And over here I'll also put a delta. And somehow at the end of the day, what we should get is that this thing is equal to the change in the expectation value of dt plus dt bar with a coefficient of minus 6 in front of it. Because if we do, then we will have explained why H mod is equal to that expression. So let's see if we can understand why that's true. And I have to look at my notes to make sure that that's true, that I don't make mistakes. So in the next line, I'm going to still be taking this limit as n goes to 1. 1 over 1 minus n times the logarithm. And now let me be careful about what it is that I'm taking the logarithm of. So this is really the expectation value of this OO in the state that I'm in. So if I performed my delta change, then I went to the state phi. So this is phi OO phi. And the change is the difference of the logarithms, which is the logarithm of the ratio. So that's like taking 0 of 0. Yes? Is everyone okay with that? That's the change between the new expectation value and the old expectation value under the logarithm. So now I would like to rewrite this expression. As I have some phi, and I would like to use the, my OPE block expansion on the product of these two operators. So remember when I had the product of two operators, O and O, then the first thing I would do is I would take the difference between them and raise it to the power minus delta times minus the other delta, if they have different deltas. But now they have the same delta, so this is just minus 2 delta. And then over here, I have the sum over OPE coefficients, such as delta, delta, times some operator, and the OPE blocks of those operators. This was the expression of this O for this OO. This expression, in fact, is nothing but the two-point function of my O's. Okay? I can't do this in the vacuum. I can't do this exact in general, because if these these conformal dimensions were different, then I would still have the non-vanishing thing in front here. But if they are the same, then in fact I can just write this. So let me do this. Notice that this is just a constant multiplier in front of everything. So let me pull out this constant out in front, and what I will get in the numerator here is 0. Times my state phi, expectation value in it, of the second part of the expansion of the OPE block, which starts from just 1. That's the two-point function of the two operators themselves. That's like the OPE block of identity, which is of the identity operator. And then I have to have a sum over all possible operators which have a non-vanishing OPE block with a pair of two operators. So it turns out that this sum here has the following form. First, I have to have the identity. If I didn't have the identity, then taking the expectation of value of this in the vacuum would not give me the two-point function that I want, yes? Like, suppose that I didn't have identity here, or I had some other number. Then setting phi equal to the vacuum would give me that constant multiplying the two-point function. But I needed the two-point function itself, so identity is necessary. And after that, what I have is that the first non-vanishing OPE block happens to, no, non-vanishing OPE coefficient is known because it's universal for any two operators that have the same conformal dimension. And in the normalization that we have here, this has the form, I have to look this up to not miss is equal to delta over C times B of T, and I will also have delta over C times B T bar. These are the first, this guy and this guy are the first non-trivial OPE coefficients that I have in this expansion. These are the OPE coefficients that multiply my d's, and it's precisely dt and dt bar. So, okay, I will not get there by here, so let me erase this. This will be our bottom goal, minus 6 pi dt plus dt bar. So that means that what I have to have here is the expression is delta over C times dt, delta over C times dt bar, and actually other terms. But it turns out that those other terms have OPE coefficients which are proportional to 1 minus n squared. And because they're proportional to 1 minus n squared, it's going to cancel out with this 1 minus n squared, with this 1 minus n, so I can just forget about that. But we'll see that in a moment. So let's continue my expression. I have 1 plus delta over C times dt. But let me erase this right now. Instead, let me replace this with the expression for delta over C that I already have, because delta is equal to C over 12.
So delta over C is just 1 over 12 times n plus 1 n minus 1 over n times dt, plus the same expression for dt bar, it's the same one, so dt plus dt bar, plus, like I said, the extra OPE coefficients which look like 1 minus n squared. So it's 1 minus n squared times something. And after that, I take the expectation of the value of that in phi. Is everyone okay with what I wrote so far? And here I have, at the bottom, I still have this. So it's good that this thing cancels with that one. Okay? And furthermore, when I take that expectation value, I'm going to have phi. I'm taking an expectation value in state phi, and remember that my state phi is a small departure from the vacuum, yes? What would happen, it's a small departure from the vacuum. What would happen if my state phi was actually just the vacuum? If it was just the vacuum, then I should get nothing, because in the end of the day, I'm taking the variation. If I was still in the vacuum, then I haven't done any variation. So I would have to be taking the logarithm of 1 alone, yes? So that means that this term here, this stuff here, is what accounts for the variation, is the result of the variation. But my variation was small. It's proportional to epsilon at the level of the state phi. And even if by the time I take expectation values, maybe it's proportional, it will still be proportional to epsilon. But even without thinking about that, I definitely know that this term, the expectation value that in phi is going to be small. Well, if it's small, then I can take the Taylor expansion of the logarithm and replace the logarithm of 1 plus this expression with just the extra expression that's there in addition to 1. So what I have is the limit as n goes to 1 of 1 over 1 minus n times phi, expectation value in phi, of 1 12 times n plus 1 n minus 1 over n dt plus dt bar plus terms of order 1 minus n squared, expectation value of that in phi. And it should be clear that this limit is going to give me precisely minus 6 of bt plus bt bar. And so that's why that's true. So we have just derived the modular Hamiltonian as Rob Byers and Marina Huerta and Horacio Cassini did with the use of OPE blocks. And the only things we needed to know were the OPE coefficients was the OPE expansion of two scalar fields of equal conformal dimensions. This is the thing that we used. Notice that this is very different from the derivation that Horacio and Marina and Rob Myers wrote down in their paper. Theirs was essentially a conformal transformation that they intuited from transformation properties, geometric properties of ADS space. Now this was about OPE coefficients. But you see, strategy of using OPE blocks was also based on conformal symmetry and about thinking about this SO1,1 quotient of conformal symmetry, yes? That's what kinematic space is about. So somehow at the end of the day, their formula and the formula that we, I mean, their result and our result also comes from the same physics, except it comes from very different roots. And in this case, we needed to know about these OPE coefficients. In their case, we didn't. So you might say, can you use this to derive those OPE coefficients? If I didn't know that they were that, could I have used this to derive it? The answer is yes. And then you can say, have I seen such a derivation before? And the answer is also yes. This is what's called the conformal word identity. The conformal word identity gives me a relation between the expectation value of OOT and OO in terms of some differential operators. And this relation
is exactly what fixes the OP coefficients that we use. And that relation, the word identity, is also a consequence of conformal symmetry. So this is how all of these various pieces of that story fit together. Okay, any other questions about, or any questions about that? I have a question. So this expression over here, I just wrote it for you for the case of d equals 2. But you might say, what about higher dimensional cases? Do we not know something about that too? So so in higher dimensional cases, if I open Cassini-Huerta Myers, then I will find an expression for a spherical region A, which lives in the CFT. I will find the expression for its modular Hamiltonian about the vacuum, which is equal to, there's some normalization which I don't remember, and because it's spherical, there are some radial coordinates that I can introduce which are centered at the center of the spherical region. So I will go now as an integral from 0 to r, where r is the size of my whole region, of r squared minus r squared over 2r t 0 0 of r of little r dr. So this is an expression that Cassini-Huerta and Myers wrote for the higher dimensional cases. So this guy here turns out to be exactly equal to that one in the case of d equals 2, where my sphere is actually just an interval, yeah, of size 2r. In that case, t0 in d equals 2, t00 becomes a sum of tzz and tz bar z bar that sits here, and that's how those two expressions come together. So you might ask, is this related to some kind of OPE block? But this is a very different story, because in the bulk, what this corresponds to is a change in the area of a minimal surface, which is a higher dimensional minimal surface. So I should say that this is my spherical region over here. I'm going to collapse all the dimensions but one, so it will end up looking like a geodesic, but that's not what I mean. This is a co-dimension 2 surface in a higher dimensional ABS space. The expectation value of this guy, or the change in it, is supposed to give me the change in the entanglement entropy, which is just the change in the in the area of this minimal surface. This is a higher dimensional object. So although this picture is deceptive, this is no longer something that localizes on a geodesic, it has to be a higher dimensional object. But all this time we have been talking about the space of geodesics being kinematic space. So does this formula have a chance of agreeing with this formula in the higher dimensional case? And the answer is yes. And for that, I have to introduce a new type of kinematic space, where previously we said that this was a space of pairs of points. This is the space of pairs of points. And that's okay. But then we said that this was also the same as the space of geodesics, which is true if the points are space-like separated. But what if the points are time-like separated? If the points are time-like separated, so I should say to you that this is the pairs of space-like separated points, and they define geodesics for me. But pairs of time-like separated points also form a kinematic space, which will have exactly the same metric as we said before. It's the same metric because our derivation of the metric for kinematic space didn't use the fact that the points were space-like separated. So it's the same metric. And what is this a space of? It's a space of spherical regions. Because if I choose a spherical region and I in a Lorentzian CFT, then it will select some tip of the null cone and some bottom tip of the null cone. And here could be my two points x and y. So this is also a space of spherical regions A. And in that case, is this space still the kind of quotient that I said before?
And the answer is yes, because with a slight, caveat. So previously we said that kinematic space was S of D comma 2 mod S of 1 comma 1 times S of D minus 1 comma 1. And I kept saying that S of 1 comma 1 was the translations along a geodesic. But now I want to say that S of 1 comma 1 are actually those time-like translations that take me from the bottom to the top of the causal diamond. This is the reason why I said that these guys live in every dimension, whereas those guys do not. So previously I have been emphasizing the uniformization along these directions, but actually this one is kind of more general. It happens, it can be done in any dimension that I want. So I now will think of SO1, 1 living at the bottom here as being the orbits of time translations within along Killing vectors that maintain this causal cone. And SOD minus 1, 1 are all the rotations which sort of is the rest of the little group of this whole causal cone, which is a little harder to envision. So, and I don't know if I can draw anything like that. So I invite you to think about what this S of D minus 1 comma 1 is doing. For a geodesic, it's easy to see. For this guy, it's a little harder. So good. So in fact, when I have a pair of time-like separated points, I can also talk about an OPE block. And the statement is that this modular Hamiltonian is in fact also an OPE block for a pair of time-like separated points. And that's the statement that I really wanted to make. But in doing this, we have also generalized our story to higher dimensional surfaces. When I gave a title of this mini course, I chose a pompous title, which was about extended surfaces in ADS space. But we have only been talking about geodesics and about minimal surfaces in the context of entanglement entropy, but we actually didn't use the higher dimensional versions of Ryuta-Kainagi and entanglement entropy. But now we can. It turns out that this generalization, is precisely, tells me that I precisely can associate codimension 2 in Lorentzian ADS homogeneous surfaces with objects in this other kinematic space of time-like separated points. And in this other kinematic space, the statements that we make, which we also love, such as that an OPE block is equal to an integral along a geodesic of my ADS field phi. Well, now for a time-like separated case, I will take an integral over a minimal surface. Let me call it dA of phi ADS. And all the logic that we had before will apply to this set of objects. So in fact, we also have that story. By the way, let's think about what these stories mean what this expression means, especially this one, in the case where I'm actually varying when I'm talking about the field, which is the stress tensor. So I have OPE blocks, which are labeled by various fields that I have in ADS. In the special case of CFT2, I could separate the stress tensor into two pieces, which were two chiral pieces, which is T and T bar. In higher dimensional cases, I cannot make such a separation. So I'll just have one object, which is one OPE block, which is this kind of guy, where over here, I'm somehow integrating the field which is dual to the stress tensor. And what's that? That's just the graviton. And the graviton, I will be, the indices of the graviton, I will soak up against these bulk killing vectors that preserve the Rindler wedge of this spherical region. And this is stuff that I understand Anayel has been studying in detail, so she knows all about it. But there's some region, something over here, which Anayel calls the stress tensor, and that thing contracted with dg mu nu produces for you the OPE block. So anyway, so the point is that the OPE block, the higher dimensional OPE block for the stress tensor in the CFT, is an integrated version of the graviton along the minimal surface. Notice that this thing is precisely equal to the change in the area
If I happen to change my state, if I happen to change my state, I will introduce some change of the in the stress tensor, and that will end up changing my bulk geometry. And a perturbative change in the bulk geometry means inserting some gravitons and integrating those gravitons along the surface area of the minimal surface produces that change of that area. This is the bulk version of the first law of entanglement. Remember, I just said that I have this formula, ds equals dE, yes? The change in the entanglement entropy was the change in the modular Hamiltonian. Well, I just told you that this guy here for the stress tensor is in fact the modular Hamiltonian, but the bulk interpretation of it is the change in the integral of the graviton. And this should equal to ds, that's the left-hand side of this equation, it's the change in the area which computes the entanglement entropy. So this formula is in fact the first law of entanglement entropy stated in the bulk. And by the way, for those of you who have read more about the first law of entanglement entropy than about OPE blocks, which is the chronological way for everybody to proceed so far, but it's actually the wrong way of thinking about it, because OPE blocks do this kind of thing for every field you want. And it's just a very special case that when we apply it to the graviton, we get the first law of entanglement. So we have produced our OP block story, really introduces an infinite generalization of the first law of entanglement. We have a first law of every quantity you want, in some sense, that's defined in the bulk along the same lines. One question that you can ask now is, I'm looking for the eraser. Oh, yeah. Remember, yesterday I made the statement that every OPE block satisfies the equation that this guy, let me write it plus m squared. In general, I would just mean the Casimir eigenvalue. But pretending that this is a scalar field, actually, let me not pretend. Let me just write this as minus the Casimir eigenvalue acting on the OPE block is equal to zero. And the statement was that this is equivalent, so this OPE block is for some delta and L, so this is equivalent to del squared in ADS minus that same Casimir acting on phi ADS equaling to zero. And that this was the equation of motion for a free field phi in ADS. And this is the equation that's satisfied by our OPE block. Now, I just told you that the modular Hamiltonian in higher dimensions is one of those objects. And in B equals 2, it's a combination of two independent such objects. But anyway, the modular Hamiltonian is just satisfies this equation. And it satisfies it for B sub T, for the stress tensor. What is the field that corresponds to the bulk stress tensor? It's the graviton, yes? So by using this property, this arrow, which is called intertwinement, I will go from the equation that's satisfied by the modular Hamiltonian, which is my OPE block dt, to an equation which is satisfied by the bulk field that corresponds to it, which is the graviton. What do we call the equations of motion for the graviton?
There is a word for it, really two words. Exactly. And so we have just derived Einstein's equations,
just as, again, as a very special case of the formulas that we have described. But let's be careful. This is always a free field, so it doesn't tell me about interactions between the stress tensor and other fields that I have. It even misses those obvious interactions that are induced by the OP, by these OP coefficients that I have over here. And so we don't just get all Einstein's equations, but we only get the linearized Einstein's equations. And all the terms, all the equations that we get in this of this type are the linearized equations. So to do this to really apply this formalism to ADS-CFT is still an open problem, and the openness of the problem resides in incorporating interactions. We have just completely ignored interactions because we always get the free field here. But at the level of the free field, we can obtain the equation that we want, and that's the linearized equation about the vacuum. So contrast this with the thing that I said on Tuesday towards the very end, where I said the full nonlinear Einstein's equations in kinematic space are also known, and they take the form of Liouville equations of motion. So it's very different from this. That incorporates all self-interactions of the stress tensor, because that's what happens when gravity interacts with itself, but I am setting all other fields to zero, because they're vacuum solutions. So the vacuum solutions we know, in other words, we know how to incorporate self-interactions of the gravitons, but we don't know how to incorporate interactions of other fields. This equation doesn't incorporate any of that. This is just linearized equations. But so it's much worse than the Liouville result from Tuesday, but it's better in the sense that we understand completely why it occurs, because for the reasons that I gave you today. So this is an intellectually complete story, whereas the Liouville is an open story. We don't really understand why that's true. So anyway, we derived linearized Einstein's equations, and let me just ask, yes?
Do you have any idea, like a rough idea of how in kinematic space you would see the interactions in ADS?
Yeah, so this question has no short answer, but many long answers. So we can go back and say, even without thinking about ADS, about kinematic space, how was it ever done in the CFT? So the state-of-the-art formalism is something called HKLL, or Hamilton-Kabat-Lifshitz law, where you start with a free field. Suppose that there is an interaction in the bulk, really, and you consider a free-point function of that bulk field and two fields living on the boundary as a function of where those two fields on the boundary are, and it turns out that there are some that the free field contains some stupid branch cuts as the locations of those two fields are varied, but then you say those branch cuts shouldn't be there in the physical free-point function, because I mean, there are no branch cuts. The branch cuts correspond to commutators, but these operators should commute at space-like separation. So the free approximation is incompatible with locality in ADS. By canceling off the branch cuts, you are imposing locality in ADS, and the ADS bulk dual should be local. So you say, let me cancel the branch cuts. What would I have to correct? As in, if I already have a field phi, which is free, what would I have to add to that field in such a way that the branch cut would be canceled, and you keep correcting those branch cuts by adding corrections which are order by order in 1 over n. N is a large parameter that I didn't talk about at all here, which is crazy because large n is an essential ingredient in everything I said. So the statement is that equations of this type are correct in the limit where in the CFT, right, I take some parameter large. That parameter is usually called n. In the context of 2D CFTs, it would be that C over here, which I can take to be large. So the point is that this is the correct equation when C equals infinity, but at finite C, which is what every theory actually does, I have to make corrections order by order in 1 over C, or in 1 over M. So that's the procedure. So that didn't sound very simple, right? So we need to do something like that in kinematic space and understand why we're doing it.
Stringy corrections
are alpha prime corrections, and these are loop corrections. So these are loop corrections, and you can see that why loop correct. Actually, a comment about this, just to make it clear why going loop order by order in loops is a useful thing to do. Because notice that all we were ever doing here was drawing pictures of this type, yes? So, and I said that this thing is kind of like the free-point function, yes? So there are no loops here. And so if you just work with the OPE, then all you're ever doing is taking a product of two operators and reducing them to a single operator and drawing a propagator between them as a probe. So we never get to loops in this way. So this is the reason why we're getting the correct answer in the theory that has no loops, which is n equals infinity. So incorporating loops is like finding the different ways in which bulk diagrams will include loops. But what this would do would be I didn't talk about this, but I pretended that all fields corresponded to a single particle, but the CFT also contains fields which account for pairs of particles in ADS, or higher, which are basically bound states of two particles. If I have a particle and another, they interact gravitationally. Suppose that they already interacted, I mean, they already sucked together, pulled themselves together. Now they form a bound state. This, if I put that bound state in the center of ADS, that corresponds to a primary state in the CFT. Because the difference between primaries and descendants is the difference between having a particle in the center versus off-center in ADS. We talked about this on Tuesday, that going to descendants means going off from the center of ADS. So any bound state of two particles is also a primary field. But such a primary field has two components, and those two components can further split to form loops. We didn't talk about that possibility at all so far, and doing this methodically is really the thing that's missing here. So that's incorporate. That's a more belletristic way of saying what HKLL are really doing. They're incorporating effects of these double trace and higher trace operators, which are bound states of particles, so that they form loops.
I'm confused about something. Sorry. In order to get the full Einstein equations that are non-linear, it's still going the gravity approximation, that is like the true n going to infinity limit. Like there, you don't need one more n corrections to get the non-linear parts of the Einstein equations.
That's true. So it's true that interactions between different fields there is a way to argue that interactions between different fields have to have a strength which is at most 1 over n. And there was an example of this of a moment ago here, where I said that the OPE coefficient between this O and this O and T was equal to delta over C, yes?
Mm-hmm.
So I actually had to cancel out this C to get the OPE coefficient, yes? So this is a little funny, because delta has a C itself, but it's actually over order one number. But if I was talking about other fields interacting with one another, then they would have OPE coefficients which go like inverse powers of n. So it's an okay thing to go order by order one over n. That's not true, however, for self-interactions of the stress tensor, because the stress tensor has So the point is that the Virasoro symmetry tells you how the stress tensor self-interacts, and the naive argument I just gave you doesn't exactly apply. So that's why you can have non-trivial Einstein's equations in the book.
One question about this. So if you want to obtain the nonlinear terms in the Einstein equation, you need multi-trace operators, is what you say?
You would have to, you just have to incorporate fully the interactions, all ways of taking bulk fields and dressing them with various amounts of the stress tensor. So T, dt, T dt, T d squared t, all of these things correspond to some quasi-primary operators,
mm-hmm.
and each one of them would satisfy an equation of roughly of this type, and they also have self-interactions. When I incorporate all of them together, presumably the Liouville equation amounts.
Okay.
So here we just did that for t alone, but I could be doing, I don't know about dt, but I can do this for every other quasi-primary, primary of global, but not primary of local conformal, of Virasoro symmetry. And there would be an equation of this type. And then there are also interactions between those things, because different, which are fixed by Virasoro symmetry. And somehow all of those equations together have a collective description in terms of a single equation, which is the Liouville equation.
Okay.
And a way to, yeah.
Sorry, I didn't understand the last comment to
graviton interactions with graviton-graviton?
Graviton, yeah, graviton-graviton. 3.4 supercondition
carbon, carbon operation. Yeah, that's right, so I guess...
But then you say, I thought you said that translating into the boundary, 3.4 supercondition on the stress energy test, which the two are not suppressed?
Yeah, if I said that, then that was not the right thing to say. So, what is the statement? Maybe I should say this. So there was this, yeah. So in this Google equation, so sorry for making this confusing, but in this Google equation that we wrote had the form that this thing acting on the entanglement entropy or one component of it was equal to some number times e to the negative 12 over c times the same s of l. So if I take so I can expand the right-hand side in different powers of 1 over c, and I will have different answers. So I guess what this has done is it has this equation collected the order by order in 1 over c incorporates those corrections. And I'm sorry for saying the wrong thing before, but that's the right thing to say. I'm thinking if there's anything else that I wanted to say. So we derived linearized Einstein's equations. We have this. I had a pungent comment to make here. So we derived linearized Einstein's equations here, but I want to say we derived them from what? And we derived them from knowing that the modular Hamiltonian is an OP block. But the modular Hamiltonian is the thing that knows all about entanglement entropy in the perturbatively about the vacuum. So what you could say is that from the properties of entanglement entropy to first order in perturbation, we proved Einstein's equations. This is something that Mark van Ramsdonk and collaborators did maybe 2 or 3 years ago, and it involved some very complicated process. And now we know why it worked. It worked because of this OP technology. So they had to construct some form which satisfies some property and use Stokes' theorem to relate the one to the other. It turns out that all of this elaborate construction was basically just doing this intertwinement. All right, so that's my other comment. And I have one other comment to make, so let me say it now, which is that if I have some, for example, a four-point function such as 0000, in our Witten diagram language, what we would say is that this is given by some integral over ABS. In general, there would be some contact term between those things, so there will be like a quartic. If it's a quartic coupling, bulk theory in ABS, and then there will also be a double integral for an exchange diagram of this type. So this is how the ABS CFT dictionary that we talked about on Tuesday is going to incorporate the properties of such a four-point function. But notice that this thing over here is, now that we have our OPE blocks, it allows us to just use the OPE block here and then use the OPE block there to right away, to simplify our computation. So this is equivalently equal to a sum of two-point functions of OPE blocks. And I have a sum over delta and L, and this is delta L and delta L. OPE blocks are combinations of fields that transform in different representations of conformal symmetry, so OPE blocks are also diagonal in the two-point function. There won't be any cross terms. But this guy here is equal to a sum of a geodesic and a geodesic, and the bulk operator going between them. And so what we have found is that all our Witten diagrams that we ever wanted to compute can be computed just by putting bulk fields onto geodesics. Because this B here,
corresponds to integrating a given field along a geodesic. And the other B also corresponds to putting it along a geodesic. And now I just have to worry about this. So if this was a ADS, let's be ambitious, if this was ADS 7, I would have a 7-dimensional integral over here and a 14-dimensional integral over here, but we just reduced it to a 2-dimensional integral over there, which is very nice. How did that happen? This was the argument of reducing our cubes, okay? Our cubes into geodesics. That was the thing that we did yesterday. These extra directions here actually span the remaining directions of this integral, and so that's why this is a big simplification. And one thing to say is that what are these basic objects that I have over here? These basic objects correspond to ensuring that when by the time O and O are contracted with one another using the OPE, I always only get the delta here. So one of these terms corresponds to these two things in So one of these terms in this sum with a specific delta and L corresponds to merging or fusing O and O to only operators that live in one conformal representation, which is delta and no other, yes? And then I have a sum over representations. So any one of these terms, such as this one, and let me do it over here, B delta L, 2-point function, is the same as my old 4-point function where I project it onto this conformal dimension. The projection just means that out of all the things that live in the fusion of these two operators, I'm only taking delta and descendants. That's what this B does. And I did the same thing for the other two. So I insert a projection in the middle here. That's what this is. This thing has a name, and this is called the conformal block. And so there are many things that are useful about this. And a conformal block is just this, where these guys live on some specific representation, delta L and delta L. So what are the useful things about it? One useful thing about it is that the conformal block is the basic unit from which all 4-point functions in a CFT live, because every 4-point function can be decomposed in this way. If I decompose it in different ways, by doing this and that first, using the OP blocks in a different way, then that's like expressing the same 4-point function in a different channel. Equating two different writings of the same 4-point function in different channels is the basic starting point for the bootstrap program, for the conformal bootstrap program. And so these OPE blocks are the basic units from which the bootstrap program is built, because, well, yes, the bootstrap is about using the OPE in different orders, and the moment I use the OPE, I'm really going to an OPE block. So that's what conformal blocks are. They are very useful, and in particular, thinking about it in the way that we just described helps us with geodesic, with Witten diagrams, and that's the introduction of so-called geodesic Witten diagrams. So all of these facts have been written down in various papers, some of them by me and some of them by others. In particular, the realization that a conformal block could be written in terms of an integral over two geodesics came before we came by the OPE block story, and this is due to Eric Perlmutter and Per Krauss and River Snively and one other person that I'm forgetting. So anyway, so that I just sketched for you here. The whole point of today was to sketch some of the applications of OPE blocks. And I didn't get to all of them, but that's a good overview. Thank you very much.
This other branch for the delta, is that the too long a story?
No, let me say a few words about it. So the I'm going to erase that board for, to talk about this. I again lost it, but here it is. Sorry, yes. So the starting point for that story is to say that remember we wrote our OPE block as an integral over of some bulk to boundary propagator in kinematic space, and the in D equals 2 there was a barred propagator times the primary field. So this was a smeared form of an OPE block, which was always smeared over the Kozel band with this kernel. And this kernel had these, like I said, this kernel is a propagator which lives in kinematic space. But what I want to say is that this is actually also equal to a three-point function of some external field which was applied. So let's say that this OPE block shows up in a decomposition of two operators, which are called O1 and O2. So the B is part of O1, O2 as a product. So then this propagator that we're talking about here is actually equal to O1, O2 times something that I will call O tilde, which is what's called the shadow operator. And the shadow operator is the same operator as the original one, I mean, formally speaking, except that it has delta going to d minus delta. So shadows are, so a shadow is not an operator that really exists in the CFT. That just like there were a few other questions where I talked about the replica, the twist operators in the replica trick not being real fields, then I said that the argument for finding the kinematic space metric does not mean that there's actually a field like that, even though we used some two-point function there. Similarly, the shadow is not a real field, and in general, it's definitely not part of the CFT, because if this delta is large, then d minus delta will be negative, and that violates unitarity. So the shadow operator, if it exists in any sense, is definitely not a local operator, but nevertheless, I can write down such an object. So why would I say that such an object like a shadow? Oh, by the way, so why is this an answer to your question? It's an answer to your question because of this d minus delta. So what can we say about the shadows is really the question that you're asking about them. So it turns out that this story here can be recast very nicely in terms of shadows. I mean, I recast part of it over here in saying that this propagator is related to shadows. But there is an even more compelling story to be said about shadows. Because suppose that I wanted to make an ansatz for the conformal block. So the way that I would make an ansatz for the conformal block is I would say, oh, I have some two operators, let me call them OA, OB, and then OC and OD, and I want to project onto this. Yes? So the way I would do this is I would say, this projection over here has to be an operation which doesn't change the conformal dimensions of this whole object. So it has to be a weight zero operation to make this projection. But somehow it has to know about this delta. So the way I'm going to do it is I will go from O like this, from OA, OB, and P to OB and O tilde, and then O, OC, OD. And I will, this O tilde and O are going to be inserted at various points in the CFT, and I just have to integrate over all of those insertion points. And if I do this, then this is an ansatz for what a conformal block might be. So, now, a different but equivalent ansatz would have been to say the following. Let me just say that I take OA and OB, and actually take the free point function with just the operator x. And then over here, I will take just the free point function with some of OC and OD with the same operator evaluated at y. And I just have to insert something over here. I will also be integrating dy. And I just have to insert something over here to ensure that the procedure that I'm carrying out doesn't change the conformal weights of the whole story. So what this would be is x minus y to the power of 2d minus delta. Yes? That's the
weight that I have to put in there.
But if I put in this weight here, and I already decided that O tilde was going to have a dimension of d minus delta, yes? I might as well call this thing the two-point function of O tilde between x and y. Does that make sense? So this gives us, comparing these two expressions, gives us a definition for what the shadow is. So O tilde of y, I think, has to be an integral over x of the two-point function of the same shadow between x and y times O of x. I mean, I just extracted an equation from comparing these two expressions. So you can say, oh, this is the definition of the shadow. And that would be fine, except that I have to be careful about what I mean by this region of integration. And this having to be careful about the region of integration goes back to this expression over here. So I just said that this thing is a good ansatz for the conformal block. One thing that we know about the conformal block is that it has to satisfy the same kinematic equations of motion as my OPE blocks. Why is that true? Because the two-point function of two OPE blocks, which depend on completely different points, so like this would be x and y, and this would be like some a and b or something. So the two-point function of that operator with something else, if I act on it with differential operators that depend only on x and y, it's going to give me some behavior. That behavior will be inherited by the two-point function. So all the equations of motion that we wrote for OPE blocks have to be satisfied by the conformal block. But then you realize that this expression here is symmetric, because over here I have a delta, and over here I have d minus delta. So when I act with the kinematic space wave operator on this expression, do I know that I will get the Casimir for the delta or the Casimir for the d minus delta? Which one will I get? Well, it doesn't matter. I will get both, because in fact the expression is delta times delta minus d with a negative, plus something that involves the L's. Yes? So in fact, they have the same Casimir, but it illustrates that if I imagined that there was some object which was exchanging not fields of conformal dimension delta, but fields of dimension d minus delta in between here, this would also be a good ansatz for that object. Yes. So somehow I have to take, so what this is, must be a combination of the real conformal block that I want and the fake conformal block which has the conformal dimension d minus delta, which is the shadow conformal block. So how do we take this, how do we select those two parts? Notice that our OPE blocks in the Lorentzian signature did this automatically. And the way they did this automatically in two dimensions, the way they did this automatically was by saying, oh, I'm just going to take this guy and integrate only over the causal diamond span between x and y. What relation does this fact have with the expressions that I wrote over here? Well, the relation is that if I can switch over here and go from an expression which has an O tilde and O to one that has O tildes over here, then I can equally well write yet another ansatz. So let me write a third one, which, let me write it over there, which looks like dy dx times O1, O2, and now I will have O tilde of x, then O of x, O of y, times of O tilde of y, O3, O4. Do you agree that if I'm going from here to there was okay, then going from here to there was is also okay? But what is this guy? I just told you a moment ago that this is exactly our bulk-to-boundary propagator in kinematic space, yes? And this one is also our bulk-to-boundary operator in kinematic space. So that means that this expression over here is exactly the OPE block. But for the OPE block, I know where I should be smearing my operator, and I'm only smearing it over the causal diamond. So smearing over the causal diamond precisely performs the kind of projection that I want. And, okay, so in the Euclidean case, all of these integrals have to be supplemented by extra conditions, which are monodromy conditions, which basically distinguish the behavior that goes like delta from delta minus d. But in the Lorentzian case, it turns out that what we have just done is we found a natural region of integration which performs just the kind of projection that we want. And this has a very fun consequence. The very fun consequence is that suppose that I was computing a three-point function, using the OPE block story. Yes. So if I compute a three-point function, which looks like O1, O2, and some other O, then doing this first, since I'm computing a three-point function with O delta, I might as well first go to B delta, O delta in my OPE block expansion. Which, in the language of Witten diagrams, means that here is my delta, here is my point 1 and point 2. I first went to a geodesic description which goes over here, and then I'm sending things that go onto that geodesic. But this B here was picked. Notice that in going from this to that, I'm using the OPE expansion. If I'm using the OPE expansion, then I have to be doing quantization about something which lives in between 1 and 2, yes? And indeed, my expressions for conformal blocks involved doing integrals over causal diamonds. There is one causal diamond over which I can do the integral, and the other one over which I cannot. I have to integrate this way. If I integrated that way, I would be using the wrong OPE expansion, yes? So that's what I do. So you can say, what if I did the opposite expansion, in the sense that taking this O1 and O2, I was going to project it not onto the B delta, but onto the B D minus delta, O delta. What would happen then? Well, it again depends what I mean by D delta, B D minus delta. For this one, I integrate it from here to there. But for the B D minus delta, I'm going to integrate over the opposite sides. So I will integrate precisely in such a way as this, so that this B delta is going to be included, yes? So this would be an expression which will look like this. I have an integral over what is this BD minus delta? It's an integral over the causal diamond, which includes the insertion point of B delta, times the three-point function of O1, O2, and the shadow of what I mean here. But what is the shadow of the shadow? It's the operator itself. So it's O, yes? And then, just to write down this B, I would write O tilde shadow. And then evidently this correlation function instructs me to take this and that, yes? It turns out that this quantity is precisely a delta function on the locations. So this thing will give me identically O1, O2, and O. And the fact that this is a delta function follows from comparing this expression and this expression and that final expression. So it's just a fact. So notice that we have concluded that the OPE block for the given interval
is equal to the shadow of P block for the complementary integral. And that's very interesting when we go back to the start, because I just told you that the kernel over here was the advanced propagator in kinematic space. Evidently, if I go to the opposite interval from this one, which lives over here, then that's like going to the shadow. But to go there, I would have to use the retarded propagator. And so if this one is the advanced propagator in kinematic space, then this one is the retarded propagator. So kinematic space, the past of the kinematic space is local operators. These guys here are the completely non-local operators, and they correspond to the shadows. And the non-local expressions are those ones. And both of them allow us a complementary and equivalent description of the same physics. Now you can say, what do they really mean? Okay. So this is a local disturbance in the CFD, and from the ABS point of view, it means that I'm taking some small disturbance in the subleading mode of vanish of the field as if the field goes to the boundary, in the subleading falloff. But now I will take this integral expression and give me something which has a conformal dimension of d minus delta. That looks like that has the right conformal dimension to be to correspond to the to a fluctuation in the radial derivative of the field as opposed to the field itself. And you can see this because the effective action for the CFD can be written in the form dvx ddy of j of x, j of y, where these are the sources to which I couple the field, over x minus y to the 2d, yes? But notice that if I think of one of these j's as the shadow, if I just written shadow instead of the operator, then using the definition of the shadow relative to the ordinary operator, I would discover that this is the same as dbx o of x o tilde of x. So I guess y. So the statement is that the shadows play exactly the same roles as the sources did from the viewpoint of the effective action of the CFD. So what these guys do are basically a collective description of all the different ways in which I would have to change the boundary conditions on the radial coordinate in such a way as to produce precisely the disturbance in the ordinary as an operator valued falloff of the field in ABS. That's what these guys are doing. And that corresponds to the top versus the bottom of kinematic space and using retarded versus advanced propagator in kinematic space. But that's the reason why that's interesting is that the field itself is like a von Neumann boundary condition, as in I'm trying to peg the value of the field. The radial falloff of the field is like a the first one was like a Dirichlet boundary condition. This is like a von Neumann boundary condition. And so going from the past versus the future of kinematic space seems to be performing that change between the von Neumann and Dirichlet boundary conditions. And so that's basically the set of comments that I have. And I don't have a better story to tell except this scattered list of facts that I just gave you. Thank you. I'm gonna make one more comment. So in 2D, I have this mixed kinematic space. I could imagine going to the future in one direction, but staying on the past in the other direction. And that's like taking setting Dirichlet boundary conditions in the one light-like direction, but von Neumann in the other. So that's an interesting object to consider. And that should correspond somehow in the Lorentzian CFD, because when I only set Dirichlet boundary conditions, then an element here is a geodesic,
this somehow corresponds to controlling the physics that happens inside this causal diamond. Then if I go to the future and the future, I just told you that this corresponds to going to the opposite part of the opposite, to imposing von Neumann boundary condition on the complementary causal diamond. Yes. So that being future and future. So what about this and that? It should somehow correspond to the past and to the past or to the future of the geodesic itself. Which, if I think of this as a model for a two-sided black hole, it seems to be telling me that considering these kinds of mixed Dirichlet von Neumann boundary conditions for the two CFDs is going to allow me to describe the region inside the black hole or inside the white hole, maybe. So we can keep speculating, but this is the reason why I'm interested in this. Thank you very much.